More than 400 of the world's best poker players entered the tournament here in Deauville. Today, the final eight made it the final table.
Welcome to Deauville in France and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. It's the sixth leg of the second season, and so far we've had some pretty impressive turnouts, haven't we? None quite as impressive as here in this little tiny seaside town, and it's rather nice, isn't it? 427 entrants to be exact, and you know what that means. It means a lot more money. We're talking €500,000. Well, who will be taking that home? We will find out today as we head down the Casino Balliere de Deauville, where the final play will be taking place on the final table. But before we get into all that action, let's have a quick roundup of what's been happening from the one, and thankfully the only, Colin Murray.
The biggest poker tournament in Europe ever. It's as simple as that. That's what we've got here in Deauville, the largest ever field for a European poker tournament. 427 players entered, count them, 427 players have slugged it out over the past 3 days for a place at the final table. Eight have made it, that means 419 haven't. Names like Patrick Antonius, Edgar Shavold, Mark Telcher, Mads Anderson, big names one and all, have all gone home empty-handed. And Greg Raymer, arguably the biggest name of the lot, went out so long ago I can barely remember it. Oh yeah, that's right, losing to Julian Thews' pocket aces in the first hour of the first day.
I just sweat it.
Greg, God bless him, stuck around to do some card calling.
I don't get lucky, I just try to avoid getting unlucky.
While Julian Thu got busy making money, the top 40 here made the cash and Julian eventually finished 21st and pocketed €8,800 for his troubles. Also in the money, PokerStars online qualifier Malcolm Gorse.
What are you going to spend it on?
I don't know. First, 50 tip for dealer.
Nice.
That's standard procedure.
How about the presenter? Yeah.
Malcolm out in 15th and so close to the final table, but Mum Shirley's not complaining. None, though, got closer to making the final table in England's Mickey the Worm Wernick. The ex-bookie finished 9th, perishing at the final hurdle to Isabelle No Mercy Mercier. So 8 players remain of the original 427, and here they are.
Welcome to the final table of the EPT French Open in Deauville.
This is what it all comes down to. 8 players battling it out for a massive prize, and Hendon Mob headman Ramfa Swanee's in seat 1 with over €1 million chips to his credit. That's a scary sight for anyone. But arguably the best female player in the world is in seat 2. Former law student from Montreal, Isabelle No Mercy Mercier. Just under €500,000 chips for her. Now we're going Dutch in seat 3. It's Mark Boudewijn, married with 2 children. They'll be spoiled if he wins this. Now this year's London EPT saw this man come fifth from Russia. It's Kirill Gerasimov. He's in seat 4. Kirill's going to have to get busy nice and early on. Not too many chips for him. Same could be said of seat 5. Patrick Martinsson from Sweden. He came fourth in Barcelona this year.
Stockholm, Sweden. Patrick Martinsson.
But nobody needs the chips as much as England's Stuart Nash. He's got the shortest stack in the table. He's going to have to really get busy if he's going to be covered in Deauville European Poker Tour glory.
Stuart Nash, 60 years old, from London. I've been playing poker for over 40 years. I've been playing professionally probably for about 5 or 6. I like to pride myself in thinking that I can tell when people have got weak hands and I can be quite aggressive. And I think aggression gets me a lot of respect at the table. Well, it's very difficult to formulate a plan for a final when you're very low chips, and I am the low chips. So I just obviously have to double through as quickly as possible. I won't throw my chips away because having less than anyone else is mine are more valuable.
Well, that's nearly our final table completed, but no EPT last eight's complete without a Danish man. Theo Jorgensen from Copenhagen, 5 years of pro and looking to do some serious damage. Now, Mats Ehrmark making a final table. His first ever EPT. He's never been here before and he wants to make a name for himself.
My name is Mats Ehrmark. I'm 23 and from Gothenburg, Sweden. I'm a student. I'm currently almost finished. I study civil engineering. I've seen Ram play on TV and Isabel too. Well, after playing with them here, I don't fear them. I've been winning most pots against them. It's very important to not get passive against players. If you get passive, you lose. And if players can make you get passive, they are good.
Well, now you know all the details. That's our big eight here in Deauville, so let's play some cards.
Limit is 60 minutes.
Well, John, I couldn't be more excited if Pamela Anderson was making out in the corner of this studio with your beautiful wife. This is the best final table we've ever had.
Without a doubt. I mean, we've got such a great lineup. It's really good to see the cream float to the top after a while. And it'll be interesting to see how Isabel does. I'd love to see her, win, because she's done so well. She's been so committed to the EPT, and she's really, really worked hard to get to where she is now.
Ram Paswani's had a big chip stacked the whole way through this tournament. He's looking unstoppable.
Well, we all know what Ram's, what a great player Ram is, and he's my favourite in this lineup. It's a hell of a lineup, but he's my favourite.
All right, this before make my bet. Tick Ram Paswani off. He's been tipped by John Duthie. Well, listen, I can't wait, you can't wait. Let's play cards.
Well, there's short stacks, there's big stacks, and anything can happen in one hand. So let's see what's being dealt out. Barney Boatman will be back, as he has been in Deauville, guest commentating with my good self, Colin Murray. But the old man of poker, John Duthie's back with me after sorting out his passport problems.
A bit less of the old man, thanks. OK, so Jorgensen has opened it up with pocket queens.
No mercy. Mercier is not interested in those cards.
He'll probably just take this down, unless he runs into something, of course.
And there's the pot of fives.
I can't see him playing those. Oh, Stuart Nash looks interested.
I mean, I think even with your criminal record, you shouldn't have had the problems getting into Deauville that you had. I'd just like to state that publicly for the record and support John in his plight.
Well, it's, common at every airport now.
So this is the man that really needs the chips.
Okay, so
Stuart, raise to tail.
Yeah.
Well, with the stack he has, he needs to make that bet. Only 125,000 chips coming to this final table. That's a glorious hand for him. He'll take that even against pocket queens. It's the best chance he's going to have.
Yeah, Theo's trying to work out now, am I up against aces or kings? But even if he is, he's going to call, I think.
And Theo announces all in.
Of course, and this is the throw of the dice then, and the turn of the card for Stuart Nash from England. He knew he was either going to need to double up early or go out very early and have a nice day here in Deauville. That's the reality of his situation coming in so far behind everyone. And that flop is not going to help him, John. So just a turn in the river for him. Let's take a look at 4 straight.
And here's the turn. Turn card is a deuce, no help to him.
Okay, well, he now has a 5 for the straight. That's going to give it to him as well. So king, ace, 5. That's a few more outs for Stuart Nash, and he's not going to hit any of those. So a casualty so early on. He hasn't even been able to warm the seat with his butt cheeks. And he's out in his ass. 8th place for Stuart Nash, John. Short stack, he needed the action, and he'll be happy enough. Great performance for him.
Oh, yeah, he's a very, very solid player.
Texas Hold'em's the game in these parts, so simple, anyone can play. On each hand, one player's on the button, which means they're nominated dealer for that round. The button will then move clockwise to the next player after each hand. These two players to the left of the button then have to pay the small blind and the big blind. These bets are called blinds because the players have to kick off the betting blind if seeing their cards. Then everyone gets dealt 2 cards known as the hole cards. Now, for the first rounds of betting, based on just these 2 hole cards, players can decide to fold if they don't fancy it.
Casper, fold.
They can call, which means matching the last bet.
Call 50.
Or raise, depending on whether or not they like their hand.
Oyster and raise at 300.
Once all the betting is level, the flop is dealt.
The flop is very simply three community cards dealt face up in the middle of the table. Based on these three cards, another round of betting begins, starting with the active player immediately to the left of the button. And then we'll see another community card. It's the fourth card out of five, and it's known as the turn. Yet again, the chips come into play. Once this turn card is dealt, we have to have one other round of betting. It's the third round of betting at this stage, and that precedes the fifth and final community card, which is known as the deadly river. The river card will be the final card that comes into play, but that doesn't mean it's the end of the betting. One more chance to get those chips in. Final round. The aim is to make the best five cards from the two whole cards in your hand and the five in the table. In this case, Greg Raymer picked up a five in the river to complete his full house, which beats two per any day of the week. Look at that. Count it. €43,500.
€43,000.
Well done, Stuart. Thank you. Thomas Kremser, our man in the middle, gives the money to Mr. Nash, and that makes his trip home much, much easier. More cards for you. 15,000 the big blinds, John. They are getting quite steep, but now that that small stack's gone, really only Gerasimov and Martinson's going to have to worry about them.
Yeah, it's true. There's a, you know, there are a lot of chips in play in this tournament, so even though it seems quite big lines, they're not when you're relative to the big stacks.
Budawine, ace, jack. That hat is ridiculous. Say that for the record. Great player, terrible hat.
I like it.
What's he going to? A Verve reunion gig? And what's that sticker in the front?
It's covering something up, I think.
Now there's a man with style. Ramphaswani. Never out of the Savile Row suit stores. Isabel. The King Jack of Diamonds. She's going to have a look at this if it's cheap enough for her, John.
Yeah, she may not. She may just throw it away. It's not that great a hand, really.
But if you hit it, it's just glorious, isn't it?
If you hit two pair, it's good. Or if you hit your straight, it's good. But it's always a bit of a worry. What happens if she hits a jack, you know? Mm.
The flush is what'll be nice for. No jack there. Your psychic quality still haven't kicked in yet, John, after your couple of programmes off. Let's take a look at this turn.
She's got a middle pin straight draw. Now they've both picked up an open-ended straight draw.
She's probably going to bet into this now.
She might do, and I think Mark Boudwine will at least, you know, call any bet. I don't think she'll bet. She is going to bet. You're right. You know her better than me.
Well, no, it's not that. I've had Barney Boatman in the commentary box with me for a couple of programmes, so my poker knowledge has went up a level.
That was really good. Really good.
Here we go. It means nothing. Who cares about the cards when you get comedy like this with John Duthie? There you go then. No one said anything. It's how it's going to be bet, John.
It's going to be interesting to see whether Isabel follows through now. If she does, that's great play. She should do, of course, because he just called and said the three can't possibly have helped his hand.
So will Budawine have her number, though? Will he see it as a bluff?
Well, it's possible that he may put her on a draw.
Well, 85,000's the bet.
It's a good bet.
A very nice size, because it makes it look like she wants him to call. It's not that much as it puts the pot to an astronomical level.
Well, I'm not sure, I think.
He's called.
Mark calls.
He's called it and he's going to lift it. She's absolutely distraught at that. A massive gulp. A reluctant tap of the table. She's just been outplayed. As simple as that.
Well, the thing is she made quite a big bet on the end. It's a very, very good call with the ace high. Very good call. And it's a good bet by her, I thought.
She looks like she's just been caught with her hand in the cookie jar. A good bet, but superlative play from Budawine to call that with absolutely nothing.
She looked like she'd just woken up with you the next morning.
Oh, dear. She never stays the night. That's why I'll never truly love her, John. It'll just be lust.
All right, so the blinds are up to 10-20.
Rem is a big blind now. Isabel and Mark fold.
10-20 is a lot for Kirill.
It's going to be based on position. I'm going to throw them away. Not close enough to the button, John, to be looking at taking on anything with those cards.
He's a very solid player, Kirill. Really solid. He really grinds it.
He was raising to 60,000.
Well, we've seen some of those hearts already, John, be thrown into the middle.
Okay, so Theo's raised it up by 40,000 up to with 9-queen suited.
Which is just a very normal hand. So he's betting it based on position.
Yeah, re-raise there.
Vaswani spotted that, John. He's got something in Jorgensen there to make that bet.
Yeah, he's just making a move at him. He's probably got some sort of tell as well. Theo's not going to... There's no way that Theo's going to call this. He may re-raise.
He might call it for pride.
No, he can't. He's just making it look like he's putting a bigger hand down than he actually is. He's not going to mess around with Ram. Ram's just got too many chips. Wow.
And Theo calls.
Guy got it right again.
And we go.
Here's the flop.
Let's have a look at the flop. The flop's so important in this hand. And it comes out very, very nicely indeed. An open-ended straight flush draw for Vaswani.
I'm all in.
And Rem is all in.
And he's calls all in, which he has to with that. And Jorgensen's just going to throw those cards away. Simple as that. Look, I got that one right, John.
No, you did.
It was incisive.
It's an interesting call by Theo before the flop. I mean, in a way, quite surprising.
Well, lovely to have you back, John, here. And I wouldn't... Oh, I will trade you. There's Barney's here. Get him up for the second part. You can take a break now again, son. We're back in Deauville in a couple of minutes. No, seriously, leave. Get out. You're more than welcome back to the Casino Barriere in Deauville in the final table of this, the biggest poker tournament in European poker history. Well, John Duthie taking a breather and Barney Boatman rejoins me here in Deauville today, swapping the commentary box for the hustle and bustle of the actual seats themselves, watching what's shaping up to be a great final table.
Yeah, it's very exciting. It looks to me like Jorgensen is determined to try and outplay Ram Vaswani, and he shouldn't let it get personal.
Do you want to know what Vaswani had in that big hand we've had already?
Am I allowed to know?
Absolutely not. You should have been in the commentary box, Barney. Let's just say he was in a sweet position after that flop. A dream flop for him.
Now, this man has been playing fantastically. Budawine saw him make that great call with Ace Jack.
Well, he's raised pre-flop. What's with that ace? Looks like a jack to me it is.
Kirill Gerasimov, a player I really, really admire.
And Kirill, we raise all in.
Well, he's called all in, as you'd imagine.
And takes the pot.
And he takes the pot pre-flop. Kirill Gerasimov, as you said, Barney, a well-known player on the EPT and in the world of poker. But if you don't know everything about him, you will after this.
He's a man with gears.
My name is Kirill Gerasimov. I'm from Moscow, Russia. I'm 33 old age. I come to professional poker player about 3 years. I feel really good because I play only 3 EPT tournaments and second time I make final table. I feel good, really good. I think Ram is good. Ram is best player on the table. But I have a chance also. I think I play my best game now.
Well, handing out the respect, but also realising that he's there by right. Gerasimov, certainly. One of the players around this table. You could not deny him with a great chance. Till every chip goes in front of Kirill, that's when we'll say he's not got a chance. Well, you've been sitting around there, Barney. You've been watching the action from down there. And certainly there's a nice buzz around this table.
Yeah, I say Mercier are getting a little bit antsy since she got called on that bluff.
Yes.
Mark says raise.
Well, she's raised there with the low suited connectors and the high suited connectors yet again with Mark Boudwine, who's taken her down once and could well do so again here, Barney. Mercier is all in. Well, she's hit a pair of sevens at this stage, and a small nervous smile spreads across her face. Four straight makes no difference whatsoever in terms of Budewijn getting back in this hand. And the aid comes. And it's praise the Lord for Isabel Mercier. Well, as you said, a bit antsy.
Well, you know, if you get your chips in first, you're never wrong, and she made a perfectly reasonable play there.
And she doubles up and repairs some of the damage caused earlier by that very man.
Seven eyes suited and connecting is like Christmas. My name is Isabel Mercier. I'm a regular on the EPT Tour. My poker name is Isabel No Mercy Mercier. I'm 30 years old. I'm from Montreal, Canada. It feels really good. I've been waiting for this. I've been working for this all year long. This is a funny table. I mean, it's going to be really, really hard, but this is something I like. It's a lot of challenge, and it forces me to push my limits further. I'm sure I'm going to do stuff that I don't even know I'm capable of doing, because I'm going to have to, because those players play so good. It can be good to be less aggressive when everybody is super aggressive. Maybe I'm going to just sit back a little bit, chill out, or not. Maybe everybody's going to be stressed. Maybe some players don't have much TV experience, are going to play more carefully. I don't know, so I'll see. I mean, it's hard to predict. My only plan is to win. I'll manage to find a way to do it.
Confident talk from No Mercy. Don't worry, Barney. John needs his rest. He's getting old, but then we'll let you back down there. We'll see your mug again in the crowd soon.
What a treat.
Nice to keep you for one more hand. And let's see what type of hand it is. Jorgensen raising pre-flop, Barney.
Well, he's a good, aggressive player. Uses his chips well. There's another good, aggressive player.
Well, no decision there. Let's get round to the small blind. Gerasimov's got to fold that out.
Oh, now there's the genuine hand. Looks like a re-raise situation yet. All in.
Martinson's all in. 151,000 in total here, Barney. It'd be a nice double up for him if Jorgensen calls it and the flop goes according to plan.
He's just looking at the pot odd situation. He decided he's committed too many chips. He won't mind it too much with two fresh cards and a fresh suit. He's not too far behind the ace-queen.
Well, he's got live cards. The king of the eight on the flop's going to be very good news for him indeed. And two clubs now on board, Barney. It's hold your breath time.
Something for everybody here.
But not enough yet for Jorgensen. He's one card with a lot of outs, and that is not one of them. It'll be the kickers that does it for Martinsen, who doubles up here, Barney, and that's your one-way ticket back to the table. Just before you go, who's your money on?
Who do you think?
Absolutely. Has to be the crazy horse. Let's take a look at the chip count. Thanks very much, Barney. Unfortunately, John's coming back. Well, here's Barney's tip right at the top of the pile with nearly a million and a quarter chips. But the Dutch guy's been playing well. Budewijn, 842,000. Jorgensen's third, 644,000 chips in a stupid hat. And everyone else is playing catch-up. Well, thanks very much to Barney. A quick change. John, you always criticise the people you love the most. I don't want you to get upset.
I'm not upset. You know, I pulled you out of radio oblivion. And here you are. You know, gave you your first break in television. Now you're doing quite well.
Oh, dear.
Patrick Fox.
Well, the main man's back. Duthie's here until we get a winner in Deauville. He looks like an Irish leprechaun. The shirt and the hat.
This sort of hand he likes as well. If you remember, he raised his 9-queen suited earlier on. Now he's got 8-queen suited. Raises up to 90,000. That's going to go in the bin. Iron Mark has been quite solid throughout this final table, really. Oh, he's twisted his hat round again.
Well, let's see if it's Biswani that goes up against him again, and it is. He just calls it with a pocket eight, as it was a sizeable raise from Jorgensen.
Yeah, in a way that should may, you know, that might give itself away. I'd have possibly re-raised with the eighth against that player.
Well, the docks are no good for Isabel.
Two players.
So it's going to be heads up.
It's funny, it is like a personal battle between these two.
Well, they're certainly dominating the action here at the table at the moment. Nobody's hit anything. So Vaswani's in a good situation with the pocket eights, but he won't like the cards that have came out, and particularly that ace of hearts. He may put himself behind, and Jorgensen's going to bet and represent. I think Vaswani's got to throw these away.
Yeah, you read it right. He's either got to come over the top there and assume that he hasn't got an ace, or indeed a jack.
He wants a flop to come out there, 7-3-2. That would be perfect for him.
But well played by Theo.
Well, a high flop is just exactly what he didn't want to see. There he is. That's Ram's wife with Ross Boatman. Nothing going on. They're just good friends. Dinner parties and the likes over in Hendon. And Barney's on his way. Barney, you know, he's getting older. It takes him a while to get down the stairs from the commentary box here, but he'll be joining them soon.
OK, so Theo and Matt Zyermark both fold. Ram folds round to Isabel.
She's got the pocket nines.
See how much she raises.
Isabel is raising to 100,000.
She doesn't seem herself, Isabel. She seems quite distracted almost. It is a strange final table for that. Everyone's quite serious. There's no real smiles. Everyone wants to win this. And Budawine likes his king ace. He's got the chips in front of him. So he can afford to re-raise at 200,000. That's going to fold most of the table, I'd imagine. If not all of them. And she's. I've said this about Isabel. She's such a strong player, and she does seem to have this little thing today, just a little irritation at this table. And this is the man who showed her up earlier and called her bluff, and she's not going to have it, let it happen again. She's going all in. Budawine calls her, and we could be losing the best female player in the world. Although right now she's sitting very pretty indeed. Not anymore. Wow, and no flush draws for anyone, so she needs to hit a nine, John.
That's hurt her.
Well, that's it. She's gone. We've lost another player here in the final table. She just didn't seem herself. Well, she can head off now and ponder what could have been, but another wonderful performance by a girl who really does redress the sexual balance here in poker. Really strong female player, and always a joy to have her in the main table. But it's goodbye, Isabel. No mercy shown by Mark Budawine, who's staking a claim for this title.
Isabel Mercier is the next one out. Isabel, we had high hopes for you, but you didn't have much choice, so you went in with a pair of nines. And he hit an ace on the turn for ace-king.
Yeah, I'm not happy about it. I don't think it makes a difference. I mean, when I raise, I know I'm going to put the rest in, whatever happens. So I don't think it makes a difference if I go all in right away. He's going to call anyway with ace-king. I think so. And maybe it looks even more suspicious if I go all in right away. Maybe I'm going to get called by other things I don't want to. So I decide to just throw in a regular raise. But, I mean, the blinds are just so high. I'm not going to go away from pocket nines and fold and wait and pray.
Well, it's your first EPT final table, so you must be pleased.
I'm very happy, especially last year in Monte Carlo. I made it to the final 10, and then the first 10 of the final, I got a huge beat. So this, I still have it here. It's going to go away one day after I win the tournament. So I have big hope for next Monte Carlo. I think I'm going to do good. I'm in great form, and I really want it. I have the rage.
We want it for you too. Well, good luck. We look forward
to
seeing you there.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Woman in such passion and commitment.
Yeah, it really hurts when she gets knocked out of these tournaments. She's more composed than she usually is, but she really, really does. She's a very hungry player, very hungry.
But we see people all the time win big. This is the biggest tournament Europe's ever seen, and they're only going to get bigger in the EPT. And you see people win massive prizes, and they do the interview after. No offence, nice people. You would have thought they'd just won £2.
I know, it is amazing.
€2, should I say, for people watching across the continent.
Coming in with a raise to 120,000.
Buddha Wine raises another 80,000. And my favourite hand, ace-8. Never lose an ace-8. I'll predict Buddha Wine will win on it because I'm doing the commentary.
A dead man's hand. Wild Bill Hickok.
That's right. Well, I've never been shot when I had this hand, but I've won a few quid. I won my first tournament on ace-8, which is why it's my favourite hand.
Okay. I won the Poker Million on ace-8.
Well, I won $2,500 on it, so eat that.
80,000 plus 200,000.
Okay, so Theo's obviously spotted something, a weakness in Mark Boudwine. Yeah, there he goes, he's folded. Very good re-raise.
If only he knew, John, that that was our favourite hand. Jorgensen's big pre-flop. He likes to throw his chips in there and take the chance. And it paid off that time.
And yeah, he also likes to protect his big blind too, you know. There's a pretty good chance that somebody late on could be stealing with a, you know, a mediocre hand. Indeed, that was what was happening there.
Well, a very good hand for the big man. He's in with shite here in Deauville. Welcome back to Deauville, home of the sixth leg of the second season of the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. We've already had two casualties. Not good to sit near that dealer. Six players. As the numbers decrease, of course, the hand values increase.
Okay, so Earmark wakes up with ace, nine of clubs. He's raising, finally.
Well, yeah, we've seen nothing from him whatsoever.
They're probably taking for a very big hand.
That's a big raise, another 209,000.
Mark's got a call.
Okay, so Boudwine has called with the ace jack.
King queen folded out. Good fold by Theo. I mean, many amateur players are sort of people who play nice would say as a massive hand, but he knows there's aces out there.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a big call by Boudwine here, but ace jack, it's not that big a hand.
Okay, and we see the flop.
Now he says he's betting in the dark. Oh, he's bet ahead of the flop coming out. He's made the bet before the flop came out of 200,000, an automatic bet. What type of move is that at this stage, John?
It's a move that puts your opponent under an enormous amount of pressure. He's got to call all his chips now, all of his chips. And Mark Boudwine's gambling that one in three times your opponent will not, you know, hit. You know, one in three times they'll hit the flop. Two out of three times they won't hit it. So he's making that gamble.
Just make that clear. After the raising pre-flop, before the flop came out, Mark Boudwine put in 200,000 chips in the dark, and that's enough to fold out Earmark. What a play.
Bit of a gamble, though, too, because if he'd had aces or kings, you know, he's forced to call. It's a sort of move that I quite like to make sometimes, but you often get caught out.
Well, we've never seen that in the European Poker Tour before, certainly not at a final table, and certainly not on camera. It's something new. I don't think I've ever seen that on TV, actually. Well, what a move. Mark Boudwine is psyched out Isabelle Mercier earlier on. Certainly had a read on her. Now put Earmark in his place. He's developing as a serious contender in Deauville.
Well, Earmark's got to go all in with his hand. Pair of seven.
Well, he does exactly that.
Kirill, I don't think I've seen play a hand. I mean, he hasn't had a hand to play yet.
He's done very little. King 10.
Let's see whether Martinson plays this. I can't imagine he will, but he's got, you know, he's got 40,000 already invested in the pot. I can't see him playing it.
Well, he will need that other 186,000 and... Oh, maybe he just sees this as a shot to try and get a few chips up. And if, you know,
If he could see Earmark's hand, he'd call like a shot, because you know it's an even money shot. So he'd probably take a punt.
He also knows Earmark needs to make that bet, and in that position he might not be betting with much, and he does call it.
But they got more chips, which means Mats is the only player.
Mats Earmark's all in, as you've just heard. Martinson's okay. King 10, a few chips left, but not enough to win this. He needs this as well. Effectively, Martinson may as well be out if he loses this hand. This is big for both players. Martinson's looking for a king or a 10.
He's got trips. Earmark's got trips straight away.
I'm trying to look at some sort of out here. Well, he hasn't got any at all. So Martinson loses the hand, but good news for Earmark. He doubles up. And he can sit back down, maybe even take that hood down. Relax a bit, because he's not going anywhere just yet. Martinson has been crippled. You can see it written in his face. He knows. He made the right call, as you said. He went in with almost an even money shot, and he hasn't got a big stack either.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, he shouldn't. The thing is, you've got to feel your instinct. You know, feel your instincts here. And I don't know. He didn't look comfortable making that call. Maybe he should have just waited a couple more hands. And who knows what may have happened?
Well, he was just going through the blinds. He would have had three cards there for four hands. Well, there's the face of a desperate man.
So Earmark's back in it now. He's got, you know, he's got chips to play with. If he starts picking up some hands, he could do very well here.
And of course, Martinson now is faced with that small blind and only a few chips in his hand, so it's probably going to be an automatic call for him.
Oh yeah, he's definitely committed now with any two cards. See what Ram does with that. Six-handed, king suited. Well, he knows he's going to get at least a call from Martinson. Okay, so he's just called the 40,000 big blind.
He made enough of a show of it, though, to maybe tell the players ahead of him that he had better cards than maybe what he has.
Yeah. Okay, so there's a 16,000 side pot between Jorgensen and Vaswani,
which is absolutely nothing. Now Jorgensen's hit the middle pair, Vaswani's hit the bottom pair, and that's not good news for Martinson at this stage. He's got absolutely nothing. Vaswani picks up the trips. We might get a bit of a side pot now, John, because Jorgensen's got two pair.
Yeah, well, he might try to just steal the 16,000. It hardly seems worth it, to be honest.
Well, it won't be worth it for him, because Vaswani's got the trip sixes. Throws in what?
30,000, was it? 40,000.
Vaswani just call this. Will he raise, John?
I think he'll probably just call. Or he should just call. He's got trips. He knows he's got him. He must know he's got Theo Jorgensen dominated.
He'll only be worried about the club coming out at the end. But the main story here at the moment is that Martinson's about to leave the EPT. He's now drawn dead. And Ram Vaswani's got the poker sixes in his hand. Fantastic. Four sixes. Good check, Theo.
And Ram bets.
And you want to fold now. 140,000.
Theo folds, side pot close to Ram.
Folding the full house.
Ram shows the six.
Poker sixes. Martinson's head must be in his hands. What a way to go out. He was forced to go in the small blind. The Swanee hits four sixes. And Patrick Mortensen hits 76,800 euros. The second final table of this EPT, Barcelona, and now he's doing very well, which is probably why he left with a smile.
He decided to bet. That was the funny thing.
Well, John, Patrick's went out with more of a whimper than a bang there. A bit out of sorts today, maybe?
Well, I don't. It's strange. Is he unusually passive? He's normally much more aggressive than that, and I would have expected him to come to this final table with real fire in his heart, but he just feels out of sorts. Sometimes you do. I mean, there are days where you sit at a poker table, you just don't feel in the mood, you don't feel very bullish, your timing's all wrong. Maybe he was in that zone, not the winning zone.
Well, he can be passive in 5 minutes from now when he's sitting on his bed, sixth place in the EBT here in Deauville with 80,000 euros spread all over his body. Who's going to win at five left?
Well,
exactly. Have
I don't
clue.
Know.
Let's get back to the table.
Five players left here, Deauville. Big blinds now up to 50,000, small blinds 25,000, and 5,000 for the players who aren't involved in those two mandatory bets.
Now these blinds are getting quite meaty. 100,000 in the every single round.
Looks like two nines for Vaswani. On the button. He's going to bet this heavy, John. Absolutely not. He just calls in the button. I'd expect Vaswani to raise in the button with that.
Well, it's an interesting and possibly quite a dangerous move. He's trying to get all of Kirill's chips. Kirill will smell a rat here, probably. Yeah.
Kirill checks two players, Kirill and Rem.
Let's see if the flop helps Gerasimov.
Well, yeah, you go, you see.
Trip fives for Gerasimov, the one in his hand, the two on the flop. Well, let's see how this works out. Certainly a lucky flop for Gerasimov.
Well, you say that again. I mean, it just goes to show that if Ram had raised pre-flop, there's no way that Kirill could have called with the deuce five. But now Ram's got to throw his hand away.
Well, I hope he does. Otherwise, it'd be a very costly move he's put on Kirill. Problems. Problems. A strange call.
Yeah, it's he's kind of got himself into this situation, Ram. He's tried to trap Kirill into making a move like that.
There's no other draws for Ram at all. He would need to actually hit one of the two remaining nines. That's if they haven't been folded by another player.
Yeah, Kirill can go all in here now, because now that he knows that Ram doesn't believe him, he can move all in and Ram will call.
A cheeky move on the button could prove costly in the overall outcome of this event, with Vaswani could get hit big here.
Oh no, he folded.
Well, good fold. We'll say that. But a lucky flop for Kirill, and he played it well. Once the luck was with him, he showed wise on this final table. And Vaswani doesn't want to be pulling too many of those moves. He should stick to being his boisterous, bullying self. That's what we love about him.
And just take the 100,000 and blinds as well.
Ram Vaswani from London, England, and I'm age 36. I actually used to be a snooker professional, and that's what led me on to poker. You know, it's the same sort of scene. There was always little poker games going on in the snooker clubs, and you know, it just the snooker led to the poker, really. My weaknesses, I like to be the aggressor on the table, so I want to have most of the chips. And if I'm not in that situation, then I will try hard to get into that situation, which sometimes could be quite costly.
You can say that again. Ram's one of my favourite players on this planet. I think he's hard to read. I think he's also very versatile and can change his game up.
Oh, yeah, he sure can.
We talk about solid players who we have a lot of respect for. Ram's the antidote to that. He's someone who's unpredictable, who has so many strings to his bow. And love watching him. Really nice to have him here, but he doesn't want to have any more hands like the last one. A small raise by Theo Jorgensen.
All in.
And it's another all in by Ian Mark. Oh, 9-8 suited, and if he gets a call, he's going to be in trouble. Now, there's a hand to call it with. But he might not want to go up against Jorgensen. He might put Jorgensen in a bigger hand here, Ram.
I don't think he can call this. You know, he's got a raise and a re-raise. He's facing a raise and a re-raise. Ace-jack looks like complete rubbish.
Little did he know it was the best hand out there.
Yeah, I'm in very bad shape, yeah.
Theo's called him. Wow.
Well, Jorgensen said as he called that, I'm in very bad shape. Well, he's in better shape than Mats Ehrmark from Sweden, who could be going home. It's Denmark against Sweden. Well, look at that flop. Two per for Ehrmark. He can probably sit down again. Well, he's got the full house now. Fantastic. Ehrmark still in this game. He doubles up. And Jorgensen might think he's unlucky not to pick that hand up.
but maybe he shouldn't be making calls with ace-five offsuit anyway.
That's kind of true. I mean, once he'd raised, he was trying to nick a steal up front. He was kind of committed, really.
Right, good hands. Back after the break. More from the EPT. Welcome back to Deauville and the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour. We're very close to getting a winner now. Marcel Lusk, one of the best players in Europe, watches on.
Chatting to Roland De Wolf.
Well, he's the man for the big occasion. He's the man for Monte Carlo. I might put my money on him soon.
Who, Marcel?
Yeah.
I think he's... I'd love to see Marcel get to a final table at an EPT event.
If only for his sharp suits.
Okay, so Ram raises with ace-jack.
That's what he folded last time around, just before the break. But he gets the chance to act first, that's the difference. And he makes the pre-flop raise, and there's, you know, he's going to go up against jacks.
Oh.
Oh, and he's called all in. One of his jacks in Vaswani's hand.
Wow.
But it doesn't matter, because Vaswani still needs to hit one of the three aces in the pack. I don't think he'll play that.
Well, no, he won't. He won't. Not now. He thinks he's up against ace-king or ace-queen here.
Well, that's the thing. Even if he's up against that, he knows he's a dog. And he doesn't want to go in as a dog in this hand. Not at this stage of the tournament.
No, he's chucking it. I can see he's going to throw this away. But I have been known to get it wrong before.
Only once. Only in 1978.
Yep, he's called.
And again, he's called.
Well, he's got it wrong again.
He's going to have to hit that ace. I mean, we'll have a look at the flop. It might set him up for a flush. We see all clubs are all spades. But Theo Jorgensen rightfully goes over the top and re-raises with a pocket jack. I think that was a very good bet indeed. Well, we talked about other options. Kings will now do for Vaswani.
You're
kings will give him the straight. Kings are aces.
Seven. Theo doesn't want to see any king on the river.
It's tense.
Or an ace.
And he doesn't hit it.
Three.
Theo Jorgensen can uncover his eyes and sit back down at the table. And an ace-jack call is rarely a happy call. Not at this level.
I think Ram just got fed up here. I think he tried to get clever with the nines on the button against Kirill and got unlucky. Then he got had to throw down ace jack in the hand just before this one to a raise and a re-raise beforehand, and both of them had less than him. He just got fed up.
Gerasimov's coming back to the table after a pee, and he's saying, "What's happened? The Swanee stack's been attacked."
I mean, it's decimated.
My name is Theo Jorgensen and I'm 33 years old from Copenhagen. I've been playing since I think I started in the sixth grade, playing some seven card stud. I don't normally play tournaments. I mostly play cash games. 2 or 3 years ago, I basically played maybe 2 or 3 tournaments a year. I went to the tournament only to play the cash games. I wouldn't even be bothered to play the no limit. But now it's just getting more interesting.
I wonder what his hair's like. Mohican. Maybe he's bald.
He's probably got a bob. A bob that's shaped like the hat.
The problem is, if you wear a hat all the time, you don't get natural oils, and that's what makes you go bald.
Really?
Fact.
That's interesting.
He's poker players, good with cards, bad with hair.
It's like Brainiac.
Well, work this one out then. Ram Vaswani had over 1 million chips not so long ago. He's now all in 255,000 after 2 very dubious hands on King 8 unsuited. Who needs enemies when you're your own worst?
Okay, so Kirill's moved all in with ace jack.
He wants to go heads up against Vaswani here. He doesn't want any other callers, hence coming over the top and going all in himself.
And he's in very good shape.
Okay, 2 live cards though for Vaswani. Let's see how the flop comes down. Well, that's not going to help him at all, although a 7 would give him a straight, which gives him more outs and increases his odds, but it's still not even an even shot at this moment. And Ram Vaswani could be the maker of his own downfall, and that's exactly what's happened. The six is on board, and the ace high in Gerasimov's hand means Russia takes down England. No more cards for Ramaswamy today, cheered on by his Hendon mob. But ultimately, impatience was his biggest enemy. He's won a few quids, but he could have won a lot more if he'd have been the Ram we all know and love.
Ram, it was great to see you on the final table. In fact, I think you broke a bit of a record because first person to reach three EPT final tables.
Yeah, I'm proud of that. It would have been nice to be the first person to win two of them as well, but next time.
Next time. See you in Monte Carlo.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks a lot.
A very manly handshake, Natalie. Four players left. Big blinds, 50,000 still. Everyone's got to put in at least five, but with four players left, those blinds are thick and fast. It means every player will have to splash out 95,000 chips every four hands. There's only four players, so those hands you wouldn't usually play now become quite valuable.
Yeah, you've really got to speed up. King Jack is a big hand, four-handed. He'll probably move all in here.
Well, Earmark's been lucky so far in the all-ins. Will he do the same again?
Matt calls on the small blind.
Oh, he's just called.
Well, on the small blind as well. He can almost afford that now with his double up recently. But what's Boudouin got?
Whoa.
Well, he's flying American Airlines, so he's going to re-raise it.
On the big blind.
He'll just take it down here, I think.
Well, let's see what happens, because Earmarks went all in on hands worse than this. And he's still in a weak position. He still needs more chips if he's going to win this. He might see this as a good time four-handed to go for it.
Well, also, if Jorgensen thinks they've both got overcards, you know, he may think, oh, you know, if they're counterfeiting each other, he may think his fives are good. He may want to call.
I think he might have got that right. He's certainly counting them out, and he's got so many chips to spur. He can afford to have a look at the first three cards of this. It might be a very nice start of the community for him, but he's not going to have a look.
No, they both fold.
And they both fold. You're right, John. Pre-flop then. Boudouin takes it down with the pocket aces. And he must have been very happy indeed to see those raises come in before he came round his big blind with the best pre-flop hand in poker. He's had the cards. And when he hasn't had the cards, he's played some really good poker. And that puts him at the top of the chip counts. He's where Ramaswamy was recently, but Theo Jorgensen is breathing down his neck. He's now went over the million mark as well. Kirill Gerasimov, he's been slow and steady. 738,000 chips. And Earmarks, one hand away from being back in it too. Any of these guys can win it from here.
Oh, easily.
Look at that, the big blind's now 60,000. 30,000 small. The antes are six. It's 114,000. In the pot before anyone even looks at their cards.
I think we're going to see some very fast poker here now.
Well, Gerasimov and Earmark are looking at one decent hand and throwing in the chips. Jorgensen, he can play about for a while. He's got ace-eight, the dead man's hands. Well, it could be exactly that, up against the kings. Earmark's going to go all in.
Yeah, Jorgensen's unlucky here. He's run into a huge hand four-handed. And call.
Is Jorgensen going to call this? He has called it! Well, again, not a massive hand to call that, Jorgensen. He's winning with less, though. And it is a real throw of the dice for him. Let's see how the flop comes out. Well, look at that. There's the trips and no clubs in anyone's hands. Earmark's got that lovely smile when he hits a flop. And he can't even sit down. The excitement of the EPT getting to him. Jorgensen. Only the straight's going to give it to him, the 10. And it's a 3, so no luck to him whatsoever. And Earmark takes the pot down with those pocket kings. Hitting the king in the flop. Trip kings. And as we said, it only takes one hand to change everything. And Earmark's now almost chip leader. Well done. He's chanced his arm a few times, and that sees him in a very strong position. We're back after the break. I'm sure we're not that far from a winner. It was was the biggest field ever assembled for a poker tournament in Europe, but now there's just four. And some of the best players in the world who've travelled to Deauville watch on to see who's going to be our latest EPT champion and head to Monte Carlo with a chance of the big, big, big one. And what a story for Mats Ehrmark from Sweden, his first ever EPT, a student who's been all in three or four times and sometimes beaten the odds to stay in it. And he's now got a million chips in front of him. Ace 4 suited, he raises at just 90. Not much really considering. Ace Queen suited, he's going to go up against Mark Boudewijn from Holland. Well, he's called all in, and this is the two big stacks going against each other if Ehrmark calls it. Jorgensen's went all in because he's been crippled recently. Only 177,000 chips left after falling foul to Ehrmark.
Yeah, Theo's just taking a gamble here. I think we'll see Ehrmark fold and leave it between these two.
And also the two players now watching on really want to see Jorgensen go down here because it's a big jump in prize money. As is it when we have a casualty at the final table. It's always good for everyone else left. So everyone's behind Boudewijn. Well, seven would make, of course, the straight for Jorgensen. He's got the gut shot. And that's not going to help him. As you can see, the odds against Theo. And it might be time for him to take that hat off and doff it to Boudewijn as he claims another casualty here at the final table. Well, he can't even get off his seat. Theo, not long ago, was in a wonderful situation to win this tournament. A couple of calls later, and he's out. That's the nature of big stakes poker.
He played a great game, though, I think. Great game.
Again, though, maybe a bit of impatience. Theo Jorgensen, fourth place, just three left.
In the end, the blinds were so high that all of us was basically not bluffing. We were re-bluffing all the time, which again meant that when you had to move all in, you had to, if you thought your ace was good, it was you had to go with it. So it was really going very fast in the end, and you never felt sure when you were sitting four players left whether you could win it or go out in fourth.
Over 100,000 euros in the bank for him.
Nice payday.
It's amazing how things can change, though, with over a million chips in front of him, and before he knows it, he's watching on with everyone else.
It's usually, at this stage of a game, with the blinds and antes so big, it's usually the player that starts hitting the cards now that ends up winning.
Well, who's that going to be? Will it be Mark Boudewijn? Will it be Kirill Gerasimov? Or Mats Ehrmark? One of them's about to become an EPT champion. Jack Ace, massive three-handed. Let's see what he comes up against.
I think Kirill's going to like his hand. He's going to think, well, what am I waiting for here? I've got King, Ten of Diamonds. Even if I'm up against an ace, I'm probably in good shape.
Well, he goes all in. Gerasimov's gone all in.
Well, Kirill's made a good move here against a player who, had he had any other hand, would have laid it down.
Well, could this be another man leaving? Could we be heads up here in Deauville? Well, King 10 of Gerasimov, that's what he's hoping is going to save him. He's looking for diamonds. He's got the 10. Oh, and the aces came out with it, John.
Yeah, it's just... it's horrible when you see that first card and then suddenly you see the next card and it kills you.
High drama here in Deauville. Aces with Ehrmark, and that's going to be good enough to see him through. The only thing that can help at this stage is a 10 or a king in the river. And he doesn't hit that at all. And of course, one diamond away from his flush. Kirill Gerasimov came fifth in London in the EPT. He's went two better here in Deauville. Third place for him. But the Russian is rushing off without that crown. And that's what they're all after. Boudewijn, our Ehrmark's going to take that. As for our comrade, it's a seat in the stands for you. We're heads up here.
He played a great game, Kirill. He really did. He's very solid.
Well, nice one, Kirill, without a doubt, John. Third place, very good for him. He'll probably go home very happy.
I don't think he'll be happy. I think he'd have liked to have won it, obviously, but he'll, you know, he'll be happy with the paycheck. And here we are with two of the players who I would have... Funny enough, Mark Boudouin, I would have expected to probably come in, you know, first three, in the top three. He's not a surprise. Matt, wow, you know, here he is, chip leader. I think even he would be surprised that he's got to where he is.
Do you think the chip lead's going to mean that the trophies are still a lot of play here?
No, there's a lot of play. I think, you know, Mark has got a lot more experience. He's probably got a lot more experience in heads-up play. You may find him chipping away at Mats's lead, and then if they get to about level, you know, my money would be on Mark, regardless of what you might say. But
okay, well, it's going to be the young buck, or it's going to be the old-timer. Let's find out.
My name is Mats Idemark, I'm 23, and from Gothenburg, Sweden.
My name is Mark Boudewijn. I'm 41 years old, I live in the Netherlands, I come from Gouda.
I think my biggest single win online is like $3,000 or $4,000, so this is pretty big for me.
My strength is discipline.
I'm not afraid to go all in. At least you got 30-40% chance to win it, and most of the time your opponents fold, they don't want to take conflict.
I don't fear defeated players, just players that comes in. I don't fear I don't fear anybody.
It's not so much luck, it's skill, and I want to win.
Well, where we stand at the moment, it's still anyone's game.
A lot more luck at this stage than the skill.
Well, it's the Dutchman we're looking at who needs to come back slightly. 1.7 million chips in his hand, but Mathieu Marc's got 2.6. But as we say, with the stakes so high at the moment, one hand can change our chip leader. Let's have a look at this flop. Bottom pair for Earmark. Middle pair for Boudewijn. He's probably going to bet that. Just 80,000. And just a call from Earmark. Let's take a look at the next cards. Well, he's the flush draw now as well, the Dutchman. Nothing much to think about here, John. It's just going to be how both players bet it.
Well, I think we'll see. We should see Boudewijn betting again here because his hand's actually improved.
It's 120,000, and it's hard to see what Earmark would actually call for.
So he's saying re-raise. That's interesting.
Well, what he's looking to do here, of course, is represents something much bigger than what he actually has, and heads up, that's not a bad policy, but Boudewijn has every reason to call this. And if he hits his flush, Earmark's in serious trouble early on here, heads up.
Well, Earmark can actually only hit the five. I mean, if he hits his three, he loses.
Well, it's trip sevens for Boudewijn, one thing we didn't mention. So he is in trouble. You can see where Earmark was coming from, because if he had have only been in pocket sevens at the end of the flop, Boudewijn, he wouldn't be able to call this bet Earmark's making now. But as it stands, Boudewijn will probably go OTT. In fact, I think he already knows he's going to do that, John.
Yeah, I think he does.
And he's went all in. Earmark can't call this. He can't go out with a pair of fives.
No, he can't. He's made a move, and he's made a move into a huge hand. Just bad timing.
What a hand.
Yeah, big hand for Boudewijn heads up. Big hand. You know, it's giving him a big, you know, stack to do a lot of damage with there.
Well, as we said, it only takes one hand to change everything. And it's Boudewijn that can now be the bully.
Almost even things up.
Let's get some more cards. Look at that, heads up. You said, John, you need good cards, heads up. That's who usually wins it. Well, it's Boudewijn hitting all the cards.
160 more.
Well, I think he's going to want to see a flop with that. Queen 10 suit is quite a nice hand as well.
Both players will look at those cards, heads up, and think that they're leading.
I think Boudewijn will go all in here. We've seen him move all in with Ace Jack before now.
I think he will.
With three players, never mind two.
Well, not an all-in bet, but
a raise,
another 380,000 is the re-raise. That means 600,000 in total for each player.
I call.
And he calls that. Well, wow. We know that's going to happen. It's just made the pot lovely and juicy, John. Almost a third of all the chips on the table are in this pot.
That is a hell of a gamble with Queen 10 of hearts. He must know he's losing. He's got to get lucky on the flop.
Well, that's exactly what he's done, John. Not only has he got the open-ended straight draw, but he's also hit the top pair.
Wow. This is going to get Mark Boudwine into a lot of trouble.
He knows the queen, though, buries him, but Boudwine's probably going to bet this.
I don't know. I think he spotted something then. Oh, he didn't. It looked like he did. It looked like, well, like he's got a call here, of course. This could be it. This could be the completely deciding hand.
Well, it swings and roundabouts, isn't it? One hand makes such a big difference, and Boudwine has got cards here that could make him an EPT champion. He's got Earmark well covered, but if these cards stand up for Mats, he's in a very good position. The king is not a card he wanted to see. It now gives straight possibilities, flush possibilities, top pair possibilities for Boudwine, and he doesn't hit any of them. Mats Earmark, pre-flop, called 600,000. He hits his top pair. What a pot.
Won a huge pot, a huge pot.
Trip Queens makes him favourite now.
That's a big turnaround, Colin, a big turnaround.
Two completely different styles here going heads up.
I mean, he took a gamble with the Queen 10, let's face it, before the flop. You know, he called 600,000. If you're prepared to take that sort of risk, then you deserve sometimes to win the spoils. He's got him dominated now.
Absolutely. I mean, that's as close to a killer hand as we're going to see. And Boudwine really needs the type of luck Earmark had early on when he came into this final table with just 397,000 chips. Ramfaswani came in as chip leader all that time, back over a million chips. Earmark's been all in more times than any player who came to this final table in Deauville. And he's now so many chips, we can hardly see the young student. It's a fairy tale for him.
Yeah, he's dominated. All in, he's gone. All in. Queen high.
Queen five's the hand.
Yeah, it's fair enough. It's an above average. Queen high is actually pretty much the average hand, heads up.
He had every right to throw his chips in. He can afford to lose three or four all-ins, and he's still going to win this tournament.
Blinds, please.
Just two words. Blinds, please. And that's enough to cripple Boudwine. Okay. He's going to have to start making his moves, and it's not looking good for him at all, John.
No, it's... I think he really wants to just get out of here now. He's got very few chips to put any pressure on. He'll go in with that. This could be it. This could be the hand that decides.
Well, Earmark goes in ahead with the ace, and again he does his walk around the table. He can't sit still. He's not interested at looking. He's going to ask his friends in the crowd to tell him exactly what's happening. And they will tell him that he's two cards away at the moment from becoming an EPT champion and winning the biggest ever poker tournament Europe's ever seen. Open-ended straight for Boudwine now. It might not be over. One more card. One more card for glory. And Earmark. Can Earmark Monte Carlo? Because that's where he's going for the EPT final. And that is the end of the biggest poker tournament Europe's ever seen. And it's been won by a student who's never played in the EPT before. Maybe Johnny will sit down for longer than 5 minutes at a time now he's won that. And sitting in quite a pile of money indeed. A deserved winner?
Oh, for sure, yeah. I mean, he got the cards when he needed them, and he played them well, and that's his reward.
So there you go, John. Mercier, Vaswani, Gerasimov, Martinson, all the great pedigree and good form in the EPT as well. An unknown Swede nips in the back door, knocks them all out. That's great.
And a very young unknown Swede. I mean, he's about the same age I was when I won the Poker Million, I thought. But... he's played great, you know, good luck to him.
All right, well, listen, there you go. Fantastic end to the event in Deauville. We're very happy. Our biggest ever entry, 427 players and only one winner. That winner is Mats Earmark. We're delighted for the unknown Swede that he's done the business. So let's get on with the presentation and our Natalie catching up with him.
Congratulations. Well done. Incredibly long final, Mats, but you did very well. You must be exhausted, but delighted.
Yeah, I'm very exhausted, but very happy too.
Now, that big hand where you had straight draw and a pair of queens.
Yeah, Mark limped in and I had found queen 10 and decided to raise a bit. and then he re-raced me, so I thought he had a pretty good ace or a low pocket pair. But I decided to call, even though the odds weren't so good. And then if I flopped a good draw or a pair, I'd just go for it. And now I've flopped almost the nuts.
Okay, well, I think it's time to take your check and the trophy from our friends at the casino and tournament director Thomas Kremser. Here's your toe.
Wonderful. Well done, Mats Irmark, champion of Deauville.
Come on, big round of applause.
Indeed, Matt wins a whopping €480,000, but you ain't seen nothing yet, as Backman Turner Overdrive once said. Next on the PokerStars.com European Tour, it's the grand final in Monte Carlo. We'll see you there.
So, that's it. You can tick Deauville off your list. Our work here is done. Finny. The next stop on the PokerStars.com European Poker Tour will be Monte Carlo and the grand final. The grand final. Anyone who's anyone will be there. And that means me. If they'll have me back, I'm sure they will. We'll see you there. A bientôt.